She has a supervisor, Dr. Sherry Rose, and Joanne is doing her PhD in education at the University of New Brunswick in Fredericton. Her presentation today is titled Hardwired for Story. Whenever you're ready, Joanne. Oh, you're muted.
Are
you
muted?
No, I can hear you, sorry.
Oh, okay, can you hear me then, all right?
Yes.
Okay. In the long ago, there were no stories on Earth. Nyame, the sky god, kept them in a little wooden box up in the Sky Kingdom. Many creatures had tried to bring the stories to Earth, but none was successful. One day, Anansi the spider decided that he would try, and so he spun a silken thread up to the Sky Kingdom, and he climbed. Anansi understood the power of story. We understand that stories are part of us, our way of constructing reality. We organize our life into tales of important happenings, and we tell them. Storytelling is essential to how the mind works. And speaking of how the mind works, language and thought are two interdependent processes from the beginning of life, and oral language is a tool for thought. We are hardwired for story. Now think of young children coming to school with their stories in one hand and their language in the other. Two powerful tools ready to support them in the development of their early literacy skills. Research strongly recommends the establishment of storytelling practices. My question addressed the gap between research and practice. I asked, where are the storytelling spaces in classrooms? My findings pointed to three different ways. First, storytelling was supported when children were free to travel. Their bodily movements were seamless parts of their story. They ran, jumped, climbed into stories. I was one of four kiddies crawling through the snowy woods, ducking under tree branches, when in that moment I realized that movement energized both story and language. Two, when children were trusted to use resources from their environment, they would seize objects from their environment and they would transform them to serve their narratives. Water beads became magical beings. What sticks became weapons for superheroes, and building blocks became cages for cheetahs. Three, when educators valued stories. In an exploration of the versions of the three bears, one educator took resources out into the woods where she coached one child in the retelling of the story while the others enacted and dialogued the drama, which in this case consisted of twin Goldilockses. With these three ways, storytelling was made visible and audible. Children were thinking in story and tasting language on their tongues. A storytelling pedagogy is a viable alternative to today's narrow, print-focused understanding of literacy instruction. After all, storytelling is a primary act of the mind. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Joanne.